Yesterday, a House Judiciary Subcommittee held a hearing on so-called sanctuary cities, which are local jurisdictions with official policies of not enforcing federal immigration laws. Members heard from Jim Steinle, the father of Catherine Steinle, who was killed by an illegal immigrant with a criminal record in San Francisco. The House yesterday voted for a bill to withhold federal grant money from sanctuary cities. The president has said he'll veto it. Trey Gowdy chairs the Judiciary Subcommittee on Immigration and Border Security. This is 2 hours.
This is a Judiciary Immigration Subcommittee meeting. We will come to order. The chair is authorized to declare recesses of the committee at any time. I want to start this morning with a matter of requesting reports from the Department of Homeland Security for the potential beneficiaries of two private bills, H.R. 422, for the relief of Karina Tursinovic, and H.R. 396 for the relief of Maria Carmen Castro Ramirez and J. Refugio Carino Rojas. Under a longstanding agreement between the committee and the First Immigration Naturalization Service and now the Department of Homeland Security, the subcommittee requests a report on the beneficiary of a private bill. U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement will stay the removal of the alien until March 15th of the first year of the next Congress. I will support formally requesting a Department of Homeland Security report on the beneficiaries of these two private bills. If DHS finds no derogatory information, the committee can then make the decision to mark up the private bills and place them on the private House calendar. The committee has approved and the House passed these private bills in the past, but they did not become law. One of the bills would grant permanent residence to Maria Ramirez and J. Refugio Rojas, whose U.S.-born children suffer from severe health conditions that could not adequately be treated in their parents' home countries. The second would grant Karina Tursinovic, permanent resident. She came to the U.S. to care for her then-fiancé and later husband, who was left a quadriplegic after being hit by a drunken driver in New Jersey. Ms. Lofgren, would you wish to make any comments?
I would just note that you have correctly stated the matter, and we are of one mind when it comes to these private bills.
I thank my friend from California. Without objection, I would ask that any written statements regarding these private bills be made part of the written record. I now move the subcommittee request departmental reports for these private bills pursuant to Rule 5 of our Rules of Procedure for Private Immigration Bills. Questions on the motion? Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those no. The ayes have it. The motion is agreed to and the reports are requested. That would be the end of the private bill hearing. We will now begin by welcoming everyone to this morning's hearing on sanctuary cities, a threat to public safety. And I will recognize myself for an opening statement. I want to thank all of our witnesses for being here today, and I want to express, Mr. Steinle, to you my profound sympathy to you and to Kate's mother, and to her brother and all of your family, and those who cherished her for the tragic loss of your beautiful daughter. The preeminent function of government is to provide for the safety and security of the law-abiding public. It is among the chief reasons we consent to be governed and bound by a collection of laws. We want those that we love to be protected, so we abide by the law in hopes that others will feel similarly bound. What makes this nation different is our respect for and adherence to the law, because the law is the greatest unifying force in our culture, and it is the greatest equalizing force in our culture. In fact, we think so highly of the law that we make aspiring citizens take an oath that contains six separate references to the law. This system of laws failed Kate Steinle, as it has failed others like her. And this is more than an academic discussion about prosecutorial discretion. It is more than political pandering to certain voting constituencies. It is more than the supremacy clause or the commandeering clause. It is quite literally life and death. And this is the real world where everyone isn't a dreamer and everyone isn't a valedictorian. There are criminals motivated by malice and a conscious disregard for the lives of others, and there are cities more interested in providing a sanctuary for those criminals than they are providing a sanctuary for their own law-abiding citizens. I've been on this committee, Mr. Chairman, for almost 5 years now, and I have listened closely to the debate over immigration. You don't hear many witnesses called by our colleagues on the other side to talk about law enforcement or background checks or enforcement mechanisms. You do hear certain phrases repeated with catatonic frequency, as if rote repetition will somehow make it true. You hear phrases like functional control over the border uttered by witnesses who are uniquely well positioned to know better. You hear citizenship for 11 million undocumented aspiring Americans, as if 11 million of any category could pass a background check. You hear arguments against empowering state and local law enforcement to assist federal authorities, and those are the most illogical arguments of all. We trust state and local law enforcement to investigate all manner of crime, from murder to sex assault to kidnapping to narcotics trafficking, but God forbid they help us enforce immigration laws. State and local law enforcement are good enough to provide protection for members of Congress in this city and when they are back home. But somehow, some way, all that changes when it comes to the issue of immigration. They are no longer smart enough to enforce federal immigration law. And even though some do not trust state and local law enforcement to enforce federal law, they are more than happy to allow state and local officials to openly ignore that same federal immigration law. Which brings us to that benign-sounding phrase, sanctuary cities. The definition of sanctuary is a place of refuge or safety. It almost sounds utopian, place of refuge, a place of safety. Refuge for whom? Safety for whom? For a young woman walking on a pier with her father? Or for a career recidivist like Juan Francisco Lopez Sanchez, who had a quarter century's worth of lawlessness dating all the way back to 1991. He committed local, state, and federal crimes in at least five separate states. He was deported five times and each time had so little regard for the law that he re-entered that border that we are supposed to have functional control over. His procedural history is every bit as disturbing. In May of 2011, this defendant was convicted and sentenced to 46 months imprisonment for illegal re-entry again. At the conclusion of that sentence, he was released from the Bureau of Prisons to a known sanctuary jurisdiction for the ostensible prosecution of an old drug case. And of course, San Francisco did not prosecute that old drug case. They dismissed it, which surprises exactly no one. And then they released this defendant. They did not return him to the Bureau of Prisons or to federal probation. They did not honor the detainer placed on him by ICE. They released someone they knew was not legally in this country and had a criminal history dating back to the early 1990s. And we are given a litany of excuses for policies like this. We are told that we need policies like the one in San Francisco so people will cooperate with law enforcement. And I want you to consider how utterly illogical that is. We are releasing known criminals back into society so society will help us catch known criminals. And of course, some of our friends on the other side say all of this is necessary so folks will, to use the president's word, come forward or get on the books or get right with the law. I want you to ask yourself, what in this defendant's background leads you to believe that he would ever come forward or get on the books or get right with the law? He was already on the books. Better than that, he was in jail. And he was there because he had not complied with a single damn thing we had asked him to do. So are we supposed to catch him again after San Francisco releases him? Do we wait on another victim? Is that the strategy behind sanctuary cities? Release them and then wait until they victimize someone else? Is that what we mean by coming forward? The president and others constantly talk about comprehensive immigration reform, but they are very light on the details when it comes to enforcement and background checks. They just fundamentally fail to understand that border security, both borders, by the way, both of them, and internal security are fundamental conditions precedent to fixing our broken immigration system. Mr. Steinle, about a year ago, there was a precious little girl waiting on the steps of the Capitol for me after votes, and I knew what was coming, so I could not walk past her. I knew or suspected that she would repeat those phrases that so-called advocates teach children to repeat to members of Congress. But I had to stop, as any father of a daughter would. And I stopped, and the little girl said, "I want to pray for you." None of the stuff that the advocates tell the children to say. She just said, "I want to pray for you." So I picked her up, and in a mixture of Spanish and English, she told God that she was not here legally, but she wanted to stay. And everyone that I know would want to help that little girl. But everyone also should have wanted to help your little girl, Mr. Steinle. She wasn't five, but she's still your daughter. And this country should have protected her. And I hope you're given answers. I hope the politicians in San Francisco will explain to you why they thought it was more important to provide a sanctuary to Juan Francisco Lopez Sanchez than they did to provide a sanctuary for your daughter. And I hope this administration will tell you why a Bureau of Prisons released a five-time illegal entrant to a known sanctuary city for a piddling damn drug charge that wound up being dismissed. And I hope San Francisco will tell you why they released a convicted felon rather than honor the detainer in place or just simply return him to ICE. You deserve those answers, and you deserve to know that your daughter's sacrifice had meaning and purpose and that her death will serve to save the lives of other people. When Trayvon Martin was shot, and even before our criminal justice system had acted, the president said that could have been his son. For those of us that have daughters, which includes the president, your daughter could have been our daughter. I used to have a quote on the wall of my old office at the courthouse. It was given to me by a victim advocate. It was from a Greek philosopher named Solon. And I'll paraphrase it, but this is pretty close. He was asked what city was the best one to live in, and he answered, "That city where those who are not injured by crime take up the cause of those who are as if it had been them." That's the kind of country we should want, too. One where we do not have to lose our daughters to know the feel, to feel the pain that you feel. And we shouldn't have to lose daughters to know that no one else should have to feel like you feel this morning. With that, I would recognize the ranking member.
First, I'd like to welcome all of the witnesses to the hearing today. But I especially want to welcome members of the Steinle family and to extend my heartfelt condolences to you. As a parent, I can only imagine what you're going through. And anytime an innocent person is lost to violence, I think it's important that we all stop and consider what steps could we take, what policies and processes, procedures and rules and laws could be altered so that we would have a safer community, so that a tragedy would not occur. And so it is important, the process that we're going through at this time. A hearing like this offers members and the public an opportunity to learn more about the issue, and I hope that we can work together collaboratively to address some of the problems we were sent here to Washington to solve. Now, I'm eager to hear what each witness has to say. I must note that last night, Chairman Goodlatte and I testified before the Rules Committee on H.R. 3009, a bill that has already been decided is the answer, apparently, to this. And I would note that if 3009 had been enacted into law, it wouldn't have had any impact on these circumstances that resulted in the death of your daughter. In addition to that, major law enforcement associations like the Fraternal Order of Police, the major county sheriff's association, and others are telling us that that bill would actually make us less safe, and they all oppose that bill. I do think that the testimony of the police chief of Dayton, Ohio, I hope will be instructive, because I have not heard a single person who suggested that it was wise, appropriate, or even legal for the sheriff in San Francisco to have released the individual who is charged with killing your daughter. Having said that, there are police agencies around the United States who believe that it makes our communities less safe to inquire as to the immigration status in every case. For example, the domestic violence organizations have contacted us to say that, you know, if there is a call for a domestic violence situation and the individuals who are calling know that they and everyone in their household will be interrogated as to their status, a family where there's mixed status will not call for domestic violence. So we have to be mindful of those issues, the entirety of the situation that we face. I would ask unanimous consent to put into the record a bipartisan letter that was sent to appropriators just 4 months ago, signed by 162 members of Congress, talking about the importance of the Byrne, JAG, and COPS grants for policing in this country.
Without objection.
Noting that it is those very grants that would be removed by the legislation that is before the Congress later today. And I would also ask unanimous consent to enter into the record letters in opposition to H.R. 3009 by the Major County Sheriff's Association, the Fraternal Order of Police, the Law Enforcement Immigration Task Force, the League of Cities, and the U.S. Conference of Mayors.
Without objection.
With that, I would just say that I will listen with great interest to all of our witnesses, but especially to Mr. Steinle, and hopefully I'll have a chance to meet you after this hearing and your family as well. As you know, Congresswoman Pelosi and I sent a letter to the Attorney General and the Department of Homeland Security just a few days ago to explore how could it be that you would send a person who should have been deported to a jurisdiction for a warrant that was 20 years old, that clearly there was not going to be a prosecution. And oddly enough, I mean, this individual was deported in 1994, in 1997, in 1998, in 2003, and in none of those instances did this ancient warrant prevent him from being deported. I mean, he was also convicted repeatedly of felony reentry after removal and served 16 years in federal prison for that crime, and he just kept trying to get in. And I want to give credit to our Border Patrol, because every time he tried to come back in, they caught him, which is exactly what they should do, and he was prosecuted. So we need to examine all of this, and knowing that none of it can bring your beautiful daughter back, but hopefully we will be able to improve the situation as really a tribute to your loss. And with that, I would yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, gentlelady from California. The chair will now recognize the chairman of the full committee, the gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Goodlatte.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this hearing and for the work that you have dedicated to this issue for the last 2 years. I want to thank all of our witnesses for being here today. I think you all have compelling testimony, but I especially want to thank Mr. Steinle, who I just had the opportunity to meet. I told him that the fact that he would come here 3 weeks after the tragic death of his daughter to me, shows courage and determination to make sure that other lives are saved as a result of this. So you have my deepest sympathy, but also my deepest appreciation and admiration for coming here today. And I also told Mr. Steinle that my son lives in San Francisco. I have been on that very pier with my son and my daughter, and we want to make sure that everybody is safe. Last week, this committee held a Department of Homeland Security oversight hearing with Secretary Johnson as the sole witness. Many members focused their questions on sanctuary cities, immigration and customs enforcement detainers, and criminal aliens. And so we have heard much of what the administration has to say about these issues. But today we will hear perspectives on sanctuary policies that are distinctly different than what Secretary Johnson had to offer, and I look forward to that testimony. I'm honored to have the family of Kate Steinle here and Mr. Steinle testifying, and of course their perspective on this issue is one that we wish they never had to contemplate. And the same is true for the countless other victims of criminal aliens that this committee has heard from the past several years, people like Jamil and Anita Shaw, whose son was murdered by a criminal alien gang member who had been released from jail by Los Angeles law enforcement pursuant to Los Angeles sanctuary policy, and people like Sabine Durden, whose son Dominic was killed in a car accident by an illegal immigrant who had two prior DUI convictions. Ms. Durden is here with us this morning. I thank you very much for being here today as well. These tragedies were preventable. This administration must reverse its wholesale and unprecedented shutdown of immigration enforcement. Because the result of that shutdown is that millions of unlawful and criminal aliens are not considered high enough priorities for deportation, they are left in American communities. In fact, in the last year, the number of administrative arrests of criminal aliens has fallen by a third, and the department continues to release thousands of such aliens onto our streets. ICE admitted to releasing 30,558 aliens with criminal convictions in 2014. Last week, we publicized ICE data showing the recidivist activity of those criminal aliens ICE released in 2014. Already, 1,423 have been convicted of new crimes like vehicular homicide, domestic violence, sexual assault, DUI, burglary, and assault, among many others. And no doubt, even more have been arrested for and charged with additional crimes. Secretary Johnson's solution, the Priorities Enforcement Program, is a failure. Even the Secretary admitted last week that five of ICE's priority A, meaning the worst offending jurisdictions, have refused to participate in PEP. And while 33 of the 49 priority A jurisdictions have apparently agreed to participate, it remains to be seen how fully they will participate. The administration has admitted that when it says a jurisdiction has agreed to participate, that could encompass compliance with only a very small part of PEP. There is a clear answer to this problem. Compliance with ICE detainers must be mandatory. Jurisdictions that violate that policy must suffer consequences. And most importantly, Congress must no longer allow the President the ability to simply turn off the immigration enforcement switch. This committee has passed a bill that addresses all three of those priorities, H.R. 1148, the Michael Davis Jr. and Danny Oliver in Honor of State and Local Law Enforcement Act, introduced by Chairman Gowdy. While I look forward to consideration of H.R. 1148 on the floor, later today the House will vote on legislation to address one part of the solution to sanctuary cities. That bill is a good first step, and I will support it. I also appreciate the Majority Leader's commitment to me that we will take additional action to ensure compliance with our immigration laws in the future. Today, I look forward to hearing the witnesses' thoughts on how to prevent sanctuary policies and the overwhelming number of crimes committed pursuant to these policies. And I also want to acknowledge that Mrs. Wilkerson, I think, is here this morning as well. And she testified before the Senate hearing on Tuesday. So I want to make it clear to everyone that this committee is committed to addressing this problem in a comprehensive way. And we have taken the first step by bringing the bill to the floor today, but that should not be the end. That should be the beginning of our efforts to make sure that American citizens are safe in their cities around the country. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman from Virginia yields back. The gentlelady from California is recognized briefly for unanimous consent.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I should have asked earlier for unanimous consent to enter Ranking Member Conyers' statement into the record. And I would also ask unanimous consent to enter into the record 137 statements, including from the Archbishop of San Francisco Church World Services and the Methodists and 134 other organizations on this subject.
Without objection. We welcome our very distinguished panel of witnesses today. I would ask you to all rise so I can administer an oath. Do you swear the testimony you're about to give should be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? May the record reflect all the witnesses answered in the affirmative. I will introduce you en banc and then recognize you individually for your opening statement. From left to right, Mr. Jim Steinle of Pleasanton, California, is the father of Kate Steinle, who was murdered on July the 1st, 2015, by a recidivist criminal alien who had been released from the San Francisco Sheriff's Department. Sheriff Scott Jones started with Sacramento County Sheriff's Department in 1989 as a security officer and then at their brand new main jail. As a deputy, he worked in corrections, patrol, legal affairs. He was promoted through the ranks to sergeant, lieutenant, finally captain. As sheriff, he instituted an annual strategic planning process that prioritizes projects and continues to drive the department forward. He holds a bachelor's degree in criminal justice from CSU Sacramento and a Juris Doctor degree from Lincoln Law School. Ms. Jessica Vaughn currently serves as the Director of Policy Studies for the Center of Immigration Studies. She's been with the center since 1992, where her experience in immigration policy and operations topics such as visa programs, immigration benefits, and immigration law enforcement. In addition, she's an instructor for senior law enforcement training seminars at Northwestern University Center for Public Safety in Illinois. She has a master's degree from Georgetown and a bachelor's degree in international studies at Washington College in Maryland. Finally, Chief Richard Beal joined the Dayton Police Department as Director in Chief on January 28, 2008. He has more than 35 years of experience in law enforcement. He served on the Cincinnati Police Department from 1980 to 2004 in positions including Officer Sergeant, Lieutenant Captain, and ultimately Assistant Police Chief. Welcome to all of you, Mr. Steinle. You are recognized for your opening remarks.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the members of this committee for the honor to speak to you about our daughter, Kate. All children are special in their own way. Kate was special in the way she connected with people. We call it the Kate effect. Kate was beautiful. She was kind. She was loving. And deep in faith, Kate had a special soul, a kind heart, the most contagious laugh, and a smile that would light up a room. Kate loved to travel, spend time with her friends, and most of all, spend time with her family. In fact, the day she was killed, we were walking arm in arm on Pier 14 in San Francisco, enjoying a wonderful day together. Suddenly a shot rang out, Kate fell, looked at me and said, "Help me, Dad." Those are the last words I will ever hear from my daughter. The day Kate died, she changed her Facebook cover photo to a saying that said, "What's ever good for your soul, do that." This quote truly describes her spirit. After graduating from Cal Poly San Luis Obispo, she went to work for a title company and saved her money so she could travel the world. She traveled to Spain, Thailand, Amsterdam, Dubai, South Africa, just to name a few. She even made her way to the slums of Mumbai, India, to reach out to her friend's mother's nanny. She spent time there with the woman's family and came home a changed person. Everywhere Kate went throughout the world, she shined the light of a good citizen of the United States of America. Unfortunately, due to disjointed laws and basic incompetence on many levels, the U.S. has suffered a self-inflicted wound in the murder of our daughter by the hand of a person that has never been on the streets of this country. I say this because the alleged murderer is an undocumented immigrant who has been convicted of 7 felonies in the U.S. and already deported 5 times. Yet in March of this year, he was released from jail to stay here freely because of legal loopholes. It's unbelievable to see so many innocent Americans have been killed by undocumented immigrant felons in recent years. In fact, we recently came across a statistic that says between 2010 and 2014, criminal aliens who had an active deportation case at the time of release were subsequently charged with homicide-related offenses. Think about that. 121 times over 4 years, an illegal immigrant, a violent illegal immigrant, with prior criminal convictions that later went on to be charged with murder when they should have been deported. That's one every 12 days. Our family realizes the complexities of immigration laws. However, we feel strongly that some legislation should be discussed, enacted, or changed to take these undocumented immigrant felons off our streets for good. We'll be proud to see Kate's name associated with some of this new legislation. We feel that if Kate's law saves one daughter, one son, a father or mother, Kate's death won't be in vain. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Steinle. Sheriff Jones.
Chairman Gowdy, members.
There we go.
Chairman Gowdy and members, thank you for the invitation to speak with you this morning. I'm Scott Jones. I'm the sheriff of Sacramento County, one of the largest sheriff's departments in the country. And in Sacramento County, like the rest of California and many communities, we have a very diverse population, including a large population of undocumented immigrants. They are a vital, important, and valued part of our community. Unfortunately, there is also a percentage of that community that chooses to victimize others as a way of life in sometimes heinous ways. Unfortunately, unlike their American counterparts, I cannot protect my community from these offenders. Secure communities went a good way in the right direction by allowing fingerprints to be processed by ICE. Now, keep in mind, we don't have access to their database, so we don't know status, but they did a good job of notifying their local ICE offices of the folks that they wanted to take custody of. Because they can't be in every jail 24 hours a day, they'd serve the jails with a detainer that says, hold this person for a brief time until we can get down to the jail and take custody of this person that we've already identified should not be released. It worked well, and few people fell through the cracks. Even under the new watered-down version of Secure Communities, the Priority Enforcement Program, it's dependent on detainers to be functional. I can tell you that the detainer system has failed, and consequently and necessarily then, the Priority Enforcement Program is also failing. Even notwithstanding the fact that the federal government allows and encourages states to pass their own immigration laws, though they have no legal authority to do so, it's a plenary and exclusive function of the federal government, they're allowed to do so without consequence or challenge because it's much easier for that to happen. So we consequently have 50 different immigration policies that are constantly evolving. The recent Trust Act in California severely limited the types of crimes for which we could honor detainers. But then came a lowly magistrate judge in Clackamas County, Oregon, who held that in Clackamas County only, that detainers were unlawful. I and other sheriffs came back and talked with ICE administrators and begged, pleaded with them to stand with us so we could stand with our ICE partners to keep our communities safe and honor detainers, at least for the ones that our state laws allowed, because they already said they wouldn't contravene that. And they said no, that it would not happen during this administration. And in a leadership vacuum, someone will fill that space, and that someone was the ACLU, who seized on the opportunity to send a letter to every sheriff in this country, telling them that if they honored any ICE detainers, not just the ones that were allowed by state law, but any ICE detainers, they would be sued. Again, we pleaded with ICE to no avail. So now over 200 jurisdictions in this country do not honor ICE detainers. People are simply released without any scrutiny from ICE at all. California has become a de facto sanctuary state, and in short order, this entire country will be a de facto sanctuary country. But that's not the same as sanctuary cities that pass laws that overtly and conspicuously violate federal law. They, too, are allowed to do so. I have it on good authority that the San Francisco Sheriff's Office has not contacted ICE for any reason in over 3 years, despite being served with many detainers during that time period. It's deplorable and reprehensible. And you'll find no shortage of police chiefs willing to come here and testify that this type of legislation, named after, in part, Danny Oliver, the deputy of mine that got killed last October 24th by someone removed four times, that it's going to be bad for our communities, that it's going to erode trust in our immigrant communities, that we shouldn't be enforcing immigration law. It should be a function of the federal government. And I can't argue with any of that. I agree with every little sentiment that's expressed. I don't care. I don't have any desire to enforce immigration law, but that presupposes that there are people that are concerned with enforcing immigration law, and that is not happening. And notice I mentioned police chiefs willing to come here and testify. I defy you to find a sheriff that will come here and testify that some of this legislation is not a good idea, because while we're both singularly concerned with building trust in our communities, only the sheriffs, because of their roles in corrections in this country, are concerned with the dire consequence of releasing someone they know who should not be released, that they know ICE already wants and that society should be protected from, and having not to be able to hold them for even 1 minute while ICE can come down to the jail and take custody of them. Sheriffs are accountable to the people. They're elected. We have our own political voice. There's a reason, a very conspicuous reason, even though our large role in corrections in this country, that there's no sheriff representation on the President's 21st Century Task Force on Policing. And that's it. Even without national immigration reform, there can be solutions. There can be legislative or stroke of pen changes by policy that will make this part better, to make detainers lawful and mandatory on local detention facilities so we can cooperate with our ICE partners despite what the policymakers in Washington have. I hope you've had an opportunity to review the information that I presented prior to this hearing. It lists some of those suggestions. I remain deeply committed to assisting in whatever way I can in this issue, and I'll look forward to exploring any of these issues further through any of your questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheriff. Ms. Vaughn.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to testify on the public safety problems created when local governments adopt policies that obstruct immigration enforcement, commonly known as sanctuary policies. According to an ICE report that I obtained through a FOIA request, as of October 2014, there were 276 such jurisdictions in the United States. Over an eight-month period in 2014, more than 8,100 criminal aliens who were the subject of detainers were instead released back into the streets as a result of these non-cooperation policies. Approximately two-thirds of these individuals already had a serious criminal history as defined by ICE at the time of their release. Nearly 1,900 of them subsequently reoffended just in that eight-month period. Only 28% of them have been reapprehended by ICE. Now, I've just reeled off a lot of statistics that I know sometimes make some people's eyes glaze over, but as someone who also has lost a close family member, my brother, because of a negligent act by a sworn law enforcement officer and also a bad policy, and I should add that the offense that was committed was one that some on this committee would call a minor traffic offense that killed my brother, I have to say that it is really not okay to refer to these tragedies as a little thing, as one member of this committee has. I have a friend, her name is Heather. A few years ago, she was carjacked at knife point and taken to Roger Williams Park in Providence, Rhode Island, and raped repeatedly by an illegal alien who had been in the custody of the Providence Police Department more than once, but was released because of then-Mayor Cicilline's sanctuary policies. This was not a little thing. I have other friends, some in this room, who can tell similar stories. And I'm afraid that Congress is about to try to get away with doing just a little thing, just by barring funding from these sanctuary jurisdictions, some funding. And I'm asking you today to not be satisfied with just doing a little thing. This big problem requires you to have the courage to do a bigger thing. You have the language in the Davis-Oliver Act. Please do this for these families who have lost so much. Sanctuary policies do nothing to build trust between immigrant communities and local law enforcement. They do not improve access to law enforcement services for immigrants, nor have they been shown to increase the likelihood that more immigrant crime victims will report crimes. On the contrary, they destroy the trust of the community at large that the laws will be faithfully enforced to preserve the quality of life for all. Despite the widespread public outrage at the San Francisco Sheriff's policies that caused the release of a man who went on to kill Catherine Steinle, it is clear that some jurisdictions will not budge from their criminal alien sanctuary policies. To make matters worse, the Obama administration's new priority enforcement program explicitly allows local jurisdictions to obstruct ICE and also establishes the entire country as a sanctuary for nearly all illegal aliens by further narrowing enforcement priorities and severely restricting the ability of ICE officers to deport removable aliens, including many with criminal records. Therefore, Congress must step in to correct the situation by clarifying in the law that local law enforcement agencies are expected to comply with ICE detainers, establishing that local law enforcement agencies will have qualified immunity when cooperating in good faith, by implementing sanctions for those sanctuary jurisdictions that continue to refuse to cooperate, and by reversing the Obama administration's non-enforcement policies. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Vaughn. Chief Beall.
Chairman Gowdy, Ranking Member Lofgren, and members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today to provide testimony on this important issue. I'm Richard Beall, the Director in Chief of Police of Dayton, Ohio Police Department. I have the honor of serving this position since January 28th of 2008. Further, I spent the last 35 years working to improve public safety in urban areas. Through that experience, I know that effective public safety, even when grounded in evidence-based best practices, is crucially dependent upon community engagement and support. Excuse me. First, I'd like to express my condolences to the Steinle family for their loss and to Sheriff Jones for the loss of his officer last year. Sadly, I attended the funeral of Cincinnati police officer Sonny Kim less than a month ago. Killed in the line of duty was my ninth in my career. I happened to read a proverb a couple of days ago, and I think it is quite appropriate to the conversation today. Our passions are the winds that propel our vessel. Our reason is the pilot that steers her. Without winds, the vessel would not move. Without a pilot, she would be lost. I know we are here to discuss the topic of sanctuary cities and the role in public safety. As we have the conversation about sanctuary cities, the specifics of how we define them are important. And as we think about how to best protect the residents and keep our communities safe, it is crucial that we do not undermine proven community policing practices. First, I'd like to explain that Dayton's policy regarding cooperation with federal immigration enforcement efforts. Our policy states that Dayton Police Department shall not stop, investigate, or arrest a person solely because of their real or perceived immigration status. Investigation of a person's immigration status must be done only for the most serious offenders. This approach has served the Dayton community well. During the time these policies have been in place, Dayton has experienced significant reductions in crime. This is an important point I want to convey to you all. As Chief of Police, my primary concern is with the safety of all residents, and in Dayton, we have seen a reduction in crime in our city. Our immigration law enforcement approach allows us to focus on true threats to public safety while ensuring that our immigrant communities maintain necessary trust to report criminal incidents to our department. I'm concerned that proposed legislation such as H.R. 3009 would coerce local law enforcement departments to make decisions that undermine our ability to keep our community safe. The Dayton Police Department, like many agencies throughout the state of Ohio, is facing critical staffing shortages that are already creating potential challenges for filling its public safety responsibilities. Making all local police departments fulfill immigrant enforcement responsibilities will only make it even more challenging. I've seen the positive effects of community policing in my city. Dayton has a population that is only 4% foreign-born. Given its demographics, it may appear unlikely place for national immigration policy to be a much concern, much less an issue impacting local policing. But in my time as police chief, I've repeatedly witnessed how significant the issue is to our community. Within a month of beginning my service as Dayton Police Chief, I was approached by multiple community advocates who were expressed concerns that the Latino community members were being racially profiled. Allegations like this are deeply troubling to me. Our cities are safer when there is a sense of trust with our communities, including our immigrant communities. If families view law enforcement as a threat or fearful of dropping off their kids off at school or walking around their neighborhood, no one benefits. As I stated earlier, Dayton has seen a reduction in crime, not an increase, as a result of our community policing policies, such as investigating persons of immigration status only for the most serious offenses. I might add that we have been recognized statewide, nationally, and internationally for excellence in problem-oriented policing and community-oriented policing. While immigration enforcement is a federal responsibility, collaboration between state and local law enforcement and federal immigration enforcement officials can and should exist. But policies need to be clearly tailored to ensure community policing is not undermined. I agree that we should deport serious violent offenders. No one wants violent crime in their community. It is once we get beyond violent offenders that some localities and municipalities disagree over collaboration with federal immigration enforcement officials. I support the new Priority Enforcement Program initiative, as the U.S. Department of Homeland Security has described it. PEP allows local jurisdictions to work with ICE to implement priorities concerning crimes that most negatively impact public safety in their communities. I believe local law enforcement should comply with notifications as well as detainers, as long as the detainers do not require jurisdictions to exceed their legal authority to hold persons beyond their current sentence and local charges. Requiring local law enforcement to hold persons for additional time must be supported by a legal basis. Otherwise, it would ask local law enforcement to violate the U.S. Constitution, something none of us wants. Before Congress tries to impose legislative solution, I believe it should first allow PEP to be implemented. What everybody wants is a safe community. That's what I want. That's what community members care about. We should not punish localities that are trying to promote trust in their communities. Collaboration with federal immigration officials should exist for those serious and violent criminals. That collaboration needs to be carefully tailored to address the priorities of local communities while ensuring community policing is not undermined, such as through the PEP program. A long-term solution requires Congress come up with a fix or broken immigration system and clarify immigration enforcement responsibilities. Until that time, local community leaders will continue to implement practical solutions to promote public safety in our communities. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify today. I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Chief, and thank all our witnesses. The Chair will now recognize the gentleman from Idaho, Mr. Labrador, for his questions.
Thank you all for being here. Sheriff Jones, in your written testimony, you provide some suggestions for fixing our immediate problems between ICE and local law enforcement, including making detainers mandatory in local jails and having ICE share resources with localities to ensure effective enforcement. In your view, given the current politicized status of ICE's policies, what can be done to compel ICE to provide these resources to states and localities?
Well, thank you for the question. It's important to remember that until a couple of years ago, ICE detainers were mandatory. There's nothing equivocal in the enabling statute. It says local jails shall, not may or in their discretion, but shall hold folks for no more than 48 hours. It's only through policy of this administration that has softened up. About 3 years ago, they were mandatory for about a year or two-year period. The federal government literally would refuse to answer whether they were mandatory or mere request, and now, of course, they've simply thrown up their hands and said, well, look at Clackamas, I guess that's federal law. Well, that's not the way our American system of jurisprudence works.
Can you explain that to the American people? It is one judge in one jurisdiction does not make the law for the United States.
It's not even
States.
A judge. It's a magistrate.
A magistrate, correct? But they're judges, but...
I guess.
Yeah.
They still have a longer appointment than I do. So.
Yes.
So one magistrate, so it's applicable in that particular district, nowhere else. And so the federal government could have done something minimally, such as stand up and say we don't agree with that, let alone challenge it, but they don't. They allow that to extrapolate to make national policy. And the ACLU seized upon that vacuum to do so. It's not like it's unprecedented that detainers are mandatory. They have been mandatory, and that was the success of the Secure Communities program.
So what can be done now that you see this administration not doing their job?
Well, there's a number of things, but specifically relative to detainers, they have to be, once again, determined to be mandatory. The fact that you can't hold someone based on anything less than a warrant or a court order is ludicrous. We arrest everyone in this country, citizens or not, based upon we detain them on reasonable suspicion, we arrest them on probable cause. They don't see a judge for 48 hours or 2 days or 3 days. So to suggest that because you're undocumented, you somehow have greater constitutional rights
than American citizens
is ludicrous.
It is. Okay, thank you very much. Chief Beal, thank you for the work that you do in your community, but I do have some questions for you. Your testimony discusses the need for comprehensive immigration reform to help law enforcement know who is present in the community. But isn't it true that Kate Steinle's killer was previously in the custody of San Francisco law enforcement officials and thus was already known by the San Francisco law enforcement?
That is a fact.
Your written testimony contains a quote from an email by community advocates you received regarding alleged racial profiling in Dayton. Were any of the allegations in the email substantiated?
They weren't substantiated through investigation. I will say that they were, in terms of arrest data, there was clearly a surge of arrests of Hispanic Latinos that occurred 1 year prior to my arrival that was substantial. So whether the actual basis of those allegations.
Were any of these arrests taken out because there was insufficient data about their criminality?
That's what I understand.
Well, were any of these arrests dismissed or were they not prosecuted?
Yes, a number of them were
Because of racial profiling?
No, not because of racial profiling. A number were dismissed, though.
But not because of racial profiling?
No.
Okay. Your testimony notes that your department's focus on serious, chronic, and high-rate offenders. Wouldn't it make sense to protect residents of Dayton by working with federal immigration agencies to enforce laws so that aliens never have the opportunity to commit so many crimes as to be considered serious, chronic, and high-rate offenders?
Actually, we do work with federal immigration authorities. In fact, we have partnerships with the Federal Bureau of Investigation, the Drug Enforcement Administration, United States Marshals, Fugitive Task Force, Department of Homeland Security, including individuals who have Homeland Security investigation credentials, Human Trafficking Steering Committee, and also United States Secret Service. So we have partnerships across federal law enforcement
agencies. And you think that's a good thing, right?
Absolutely. That's why we do it.
Do you comply with ICE detainers?
Actually, they are complied with in my county.
Excellent. And would you have complied with an ICE detainer in the case of Juan Francisco Lopez Sanchez, a 7-time convicted felon who has been deported by the U.S. officials
Absolutely.
5 times? Absolutely. Your recent opposition to allowing state and local law enforcement officers to help enforce federal immigration law include that immigration laws are very complex. I don't know that immigration laws are any more complex than other criminal laws. Why don't you think that your officers are smart enough to be able to act as force and more to multiply for federal immigration enforcement?
Thank you for that question, Congressman. My understanding for individuals to be credentialed under 287 required 3 weeks of training. That is a substantial commitment of training time for police officers for a very specific area of enforcement. I can't think of any agencies that could spend that amount of time with personnel and training. There are training requirements now being proposed through the state of Ohio. There has been a number of task forces established, the 21st Century Task Force on Policing, the Presidential Task Force, that are, once again, emphasizing the need for additional training for law enforcement. I can tell you training time is an absolute premium, continually, or specifically as it relates to critical staffing levels. So it's how do we spend time training police officers? And I would, just from talking to individuals who are in this area of law, the law is constantly changing. So 3 weeks of training is only valuable as long as the laws don't change.
Thank you. I yield back my time.
The gentleman from Idaho yields back. The gentlelady from California.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, I appreciated hearing from all the witnesses. Sheriff Jones, you mentioned that no sheriff would come and take the position of Chief Beal. I'd like to ask unanimous consent to put into the record a letter from the Law Enforcement Immigration Task Force opposing 3009, signed by a number of law enforcement officials, including Sheriff Mark Curran from Illinois, Sheriff Tony Estrada from Arizona, Sheriff Leon Lott from South Carolina, Sheriff William McCarthy from Iowa, Sheriff Margaret Mims from Fresno, and Sheriff Lupe Valdez from Texas.
Without objection.
Also, I'd like to ask unanimous consent to place in the record a letter from the Major County Sheriff's Association opposing the idea of removing grant funding as a mechanism to enforce anything.
Without objection.
You know, I, as we seek efforts to make our community safer, we don't want to make it more dangerous. And Chief Beal, your testimony I thought was very interesting. In your op-ed recently, you said that crime in Dayton dropped by nearly 22% after you engaged in your new community policing effort, and that serious property crime dropped almost 15%. Now, why do you think this happened in terms of, was it community trust? And have these favorable crime reduction figures continued or not?
Thank you, Congresswoman. In fact, they are a direct outgrowth of not only innovative policing strategies, but also community partnerships. Our community working with us to address crime, and particularly serious violent crime, has been crucial in reducing crime in Dayton. Those crime trends have continued through my tenure as police chief.
Now, I again, there's been a lot of discussion about detention and whether or not that is constitutional, and citing one particular case. However, there are a number of cases, and I, rather than go into all of them here, I would ask unanimous consent to place a summary of a series of cases, federal cases, that have found that you can't hold somebody without, on a civil matter, at the request of ICE, absent a warrant or something else. And that, I think that's why sheriffs all across the United States, whether or not their communities say they are, quote, sanctuary cities, have been reluctant to do this. And that's why the administration has gone to this priority enforcement program, because it doesn't violate anybody's constitutional rights if you ask to be notified before you release somebody. And what we've heard from ICE is if you got a serious character like this guy in San Francisco, they will get there and they will pick him up and they will take him away and deport him, which is what should have happened in this case. Actually, he should never have been sent to San Francisco in the first place. I'm wondering whether you have any objection, Chief Beal, or whether your community would have any objection to the priority enforcement program that requires notification so that ICE can come and remove people who are priorities for enforcement, who are serious criminals.
I'm not aware of any objections from my community with the PEP program at all. None have been expressed to me. I've been involved in the committee conversations, the task force conversations, for the development of some of the mechanisms of notification, and also for basically be involved in the rollout. I mean, it's just literally being rolled out as we speak. I just met with our local field office director last week to actually give me a packet describing the program and its implementation. So this is literally just being implemented.
I would note also, and I see that my time is almost expiring, that when someone is booked into a jail, their fingerprints are taken, and those fingerprints, I mean, of everyone.
Correct.
Immigrants, undocumented, legal, American citizens, those fingerprints are shared with the federal government and made part of the database. And that has not been changed at all, has it, Sheriff, or No. And I don't think there's any confusion that interferes with community policing or building trust with the community. Have you heard that?
Not at all.
Mr. Chairman, I'm hopeful that we can hone in on the need to make sure that the ability to remove dangerous criminals by ICE is enhanced, and that we don't get diverted by disagreements over overall immigration policy, because I believe that we can have the ability to come together to reach consensus and in a way that would be a very positive outcome. And with that, my time has expired, and I yield back.
Chair, thanks. The gentleman recognizes himself for his questions. And let me just say that there are 5,000 ICE agents in the country responsible for enforcing our immigration laws, which we know there are 350,000 convicted criminal illegal aliens on the streets right now. There are 11 million or more people who are unlawfully present in the United States, and that when you have over 900,000 local law enforcement officers, some communities may want to participate, some may not. We don't require them to enforce our immigration laws, but the people who are unlawfully present in the United States and cause various types of problems, including committing crimes, are a concern to not just the national government, to local governments as well. So I think the first step is to see that our laws are enforced by the federal government, I don't believe they are, and by state and local governments. And I think that beyond that, legislation is needed to address many aspects of our immigration policy. Let me ask Mr. Steinle and then Sheriff Jones to talk a little bit more about the personal experiences that they have. Mr. Steinle, do you believe that San Francisco should have been required to honor ICE detainers?
Well, absolutely.
And do you agree that U.S. immigration and enforcement policy should not be to the detriment of U.S. citizens and legal, lawful resident immigrants?
Yes.
So wouldn't it be best to remove unlawful aliens before they commit serious crimes, as opposed to simply trusting and hoping that they won't, in fact, commit serious crimes? In the case of Mr. Lopez Sanchez, he had committed some drug offenses, and he had committed the offense of illegally entering the United States. He had not committed murder at that point in time, but this whole debate about how serious a crime you have to commit before you can be subject to the enforcement of the laws which apply to everybody gets to be problematic, doesn't it?
Well, Mr. Chairman, if I may, our intent with Kate's law is to get rid of or do something with the violent felons. The way I understand the law is, if any undocumented person comes into the United States and subsequently is deported, then comes back into the United States, they're a felon.
That's correct, and they don't have to have committed any other crime. They're a felon at that point in time.
They're a felon at that point.
Would impose a mandatory minimum sentence.
But where I see that we have to hone in on is, a felon is not a felon is a felon. We're talking about violent felons that come in here to the United States. If we try to arrest every felon, the jails would be full, and the officers here would be extremely busy. I think we need to differentiate somehow or another the levels of felonies. And that's another can of worms, I understand that. But do you see that as a hindrance?
But if you have cooperation between local law enforcement and federal government, with limited resources, they do have to set priorities, but they'll set those priorities based on the best information, not based upon individual localities trying to set their own immigration policies.
Sure, I understand.
Sheriff Jones, would you tell us about Deputy Danny Oliver, his life, and what kind of person deputy he was, and the circumstances of his murder?
Yes, thank you. He was not unlike any cop in this country who has answered the call, whose law enforcement is a calling, not a job, to help people and for a life of service. He was particularly assigned to the problem-oriented policing unit, which is, or POP officers, as might be more familiar. There are the, I call the quality of life police. Their job is to address quality of life issues, not answer calls for service. It's what he was doing on that day with a particular problem motel in our jurisdiction, had already made contact with someone in the front and was on to the back of the hotel when he came in contact with two people in a car. And I believe the last words he ever spoke was, "How's your day going today?" And then he was shot a single time in the forehead, killing him almost instantly.
Are there changes to immigration enforcement that could have prevented Deputy Oliver and Investigator Davis's murders?
First of all, he was booked in under an alias that we didn't even know his true identity for several days. Secondly, we realized that he had a driver's license that was issued from one of the states that issue him, now California does as well, had suffered 11 different misdemeanor traffic-related convictions from hit and run to DUI, was able to walk in and renew his driver's license. And he had been removed from the country four times, the first time with a deportation, the second time the next year he was simply released back across the border the very same day he was captured, 3 days later was back in this country, once again released across the border that very same day, and the next year came in this country illegally, was arrested on felony warrants for local crime, was deported again 3 days later. So not only escaping consequences for any of his deportations or prior illegal entry, but in the last case at least, escaped any consequences for his local criminality, because presumably it was easier to deport him than face his criminal conduct. Sometime thereafter, I know not when, he entered the country illegally, and fast forward to the events of October 24th of last year.
Thank you. One last question. Ms. Vaughn, what are your thoughts when you hear sanctuary city proponents state that unlawful aliens are no more likely to commit crimes than native-born individuals?
Well, I've reviewed a lot of the literature on this, and and there is no evidence that immigrants are any more or less likely to commit crimes than anyone else. That's really not the relevant question. The question is, what do we do with that fraction of the immigrant population that is committing crimes, that has committed crimes? How do we handle that? And that's where ICE needs the cooperation of local law enforcement agencies, because it's the local agencies who know who those problem individuals are.
Thank you very much. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Illinois for his questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to start off by expressing my deepest sympathies to the family of Catherine Stanley. Her death is a senseless tragedy. I have two daughters of my own, and as a father, I can't even begin to imagine the pain that her parents are going through. I am truly very sorry for your loss. I am often criticized by my supporters because I don't have a soft spot for immigrant criminals, no matter how small or how old their violations. Many argue that old convictions on drunk driving should be forgiven when determining whether someone should get deported or not. After all, they've already served their time and paid the consequences doled out by the criminal justice system. I am not one of those people who argue for leniency for criminal immigrants. If you have serious criminal activity on your record, you've given up your USA privileges, and generally speaking, I will not spend time or energy fighting for you. There are too many immigrants in this country who have never done anything wrong or never committed crimes, and I fight for them because they are part of what enriches America and what benefits all Americans. The tragedy in San Francisco has generated an important dialogue regarding our communities, the police officers we have entrusted to protect us, and our broken immigration system. The fact is, he should have never been released to be on our streets again. Deported five times. Seems to me they caught him and deported him, and he should have been deported once again. But there are serious questions about just how it is the local police should go about. Nearly 300 jurisdictions have decided that they will not comply with a detainer from Homeland Security. The fact is, the courts have said that they don't have to that they do not have to comply with those detainers. So what we need to figure out a way is to fix the broken immigration system that we have. We spend a lot of time talking about Mr. Lopez. We don't spend a lot of time talking about people who enter this country through other borders, JFK, LAX, and commit crimes in this country from all over the world. So if we're truly going to protect our nation, then we need to have a holistic approach to our broken immigration system. It breaks my heart, Mrs. Stanley, to see, because I could have been walking on that pier as I have with both of my daughters. And I want to make sure that it doesn't happen again. And I will continue to work with my colleagues on the other side of the aisle to fix our system, not in pieces and bits, but in its totality, so that we can protect everybody in America. Because indeed, there are many people who want to fix our broken immigration system. And we need to do it in a holistic way. Had we done it, we'd have secure communities, we'd have more. We'd have verification of employment. We'd have so many other means. We'd have the ability to flush out the bad people. Why? Because we'd let the good people come forward so that they cannot hide among the good people, who live in my congressional district. Now, I would like to take a moment, Mr. Chairman, to go back just for one moment. I know it might seem a little unnecessary. But I'd like to go back to a transcript at the end of the DHS hearing, which you presided over, Mr. Gowdy, on July 14, 2015. I said, this is the record, a transcript of the record of the July 14th hearing, which I stayed for the whole hearing, all 3 hours.
Yes, sir, you did.
First, thank you, Mr. Gowdy, for your excellent presiding over these hearings. I just want to, just for the record, because I think it is very important, listen to this. I want to say to you, Mr. Gowdy, I share with you the same anguish and pain as I know the Secretary does and every American should at the death of that woman. That nobody has come here to look for excuses or anything else. I mean, this is a career criminal we have on our hands, so I think we should just figure out a way. This man is not an immigrant. Immigrants come here to work hard, sweat, and toil. We should be warm and receiving. This man is a foreigner who has come to cause damage. Let's fix our broken immigration system so we can get rid of foreigners that come here to cause damage, harm, and welcome immigrants. That is my statement. I'd just like to put it in the record once again, because apparently Mrs. Vaughn didn't read it or take the time to read it. Secondly, for the record, on the floor of the House of Representatives on July 9th, quote, and this is in the record, and I'd like to put it in the record once again, because apparently Mrs. Vaughn doesn't read what actually is said in the English language that I have said. Quote, now, the anti-immigration wing of the Republican Party in this body and on the air is saying that Trump may have a point. After all, an innocent woman was shot in cold blood by a Mexican immigrant in San Francisco just last week. Why wasn't he deported? Why wasn't he held in jail the last time? Why is it? And you actually hear this on Fox News. Why is President Obama letting Mexicans kill beautiful young American women? As the father of two daughters about the age of Kate Stanley, the young woman who was shot and killed, I pray every night that no one of any racial or ethnic background ever does them harm. And I can only imagine the grief that her family is feeling. When we have felons in federal custody or state or local custody warrants for drug crimes who are deported multiple times and come back, this Congress has not done its job. Unfairly leaving states and localities to cope with decades-old inaction on immigration, criminal justice, and the range of other issues. I have no sympathy for the man accused of this crime. Murderers should rot in hell. End quote. Apparently, people have decided to besmirch people's reputation and take their words and exploit the death of a beautiful young American woman. And I will not simply stand here and remain silent while that happens. You may not believe that we should have, Mrs. Vaughn, a fixing of our broken immigration system, but don't exploit a young woman's death in order to receive a paycheck to put food on your table. You should find a more decent and practical way to go about earning your living. To Mrs. Stanley, I am so sorry about the death of your daughter. I assure you I have a 36-year-old and a 27-year-old, and I love them dearly. I can never imagine losing them. And I will work to make sure that we fix this immigration system and that situations like the ones you suffer never happen again. That has been my record in the past in working with members of the minority and the majority in this House. And I take great offense at anybody suggesting otherwise. Thank you so much.
The gentleman from Illinois yields back. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Texas, the past chairman of this committee, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Steinle, thank you for your heartfelt testimony. It is sad that we need to be here today. The tragic murder of a beautiful young woman, your daughter, I think could have been prevented. There are also thousands of other victims that did not need to be victims and would not have been victims if this administration had enforced immigration laws. In my view, someone in this administration probably should be arrested for negligent homicide or for any of another dozen crimes that are so frequently committed by illegal immigrants in this country who shouldn't even be here. In the case of the sanctuary cities, in just 8 months last year, they released almost 9,000 individuals who had been either arrested or convicted of serious crimes. Two-thirds of those 9,000 individuals had either committed or been arrested of serious crimes. In just the few months since they were released, one-quarter have committed other crimes. How many others are going to commit more crimes in the coming months if one-quarter have already been arrested for other crimes? This administration last year released 30,000 criminal aliens, 2,000 under the Constitution they perhaps should not, they had to release, but 28,000 were released voluntarily by this administration. They committed the worst crimes imaginable, thousands of crimes. So if anything, you've got an administration setting an example for sanctuary cities rather than trying to prevent sanctuary cities from trying to escape enforcing immigration laws. Sanctuary cities have increased exponentially under this administration for one good reason, and that is that the administration has done nothing to discourage municipalities, other jurisdictions from becoming sanctuary areas. Many people claim that by being a sanctuary city or area or jurisdiction, that that is somehow going to encourage illegal immigrants to report crimes. In my view, that is a specious argument, apocryphal. It is simply anecdotal, and I have never seen one shred of evidence that that is the case. It's just a simple assertion. And in fact, every study I've seen, 3 out of 3 have actually demonstrated just the opposite. One major study found no decline in crime reporting by Hispanics after the implementation of a local police program to screen offenders for immigration status and to refer illegal immigrants to ICE for removal. Another academic survey found that by far the most commonly mentioned reason for not reporting a crime was a language barrier followed by cultural differences, not fear of being turned over to immigration authorities. And a third study found that a significantly more removals of criminal aliens did not affect patterns of crime reporting in immigrant communities. It would be nice if the media would just once cite any of these studies. We only hear the other side. My question to Ms. Vaughn, who has done some research on this subject, what do you think about the arguments made that somehow we're going to reduce crimes if we allow illegal immigrants to seek sanctuary and stay in this country in violation of current immigration laws? It seems to me it's very clear that more crimes are committed as a result of this policy, not fewer, but I'd be interested in your opinion.
This so-called chilling effect is a myth and has been refuted by the studies that you mentioned and by the words of immigrants themselves when the ones who have been victims of crimes tell researchers that it's because of language barriers. So access to law enforcement services is something that law enforcement agencies do legitimately need to focus on, but the way to do that is through community outreach programs, having personnel on the staff of these forces who speak the language of the community, anonymous tip lines that people come, most law enforcement agencies have these anonymous tip lines. No one need be afraid of reporting a crime. ICE simply does not target witnesses or victims of crime for immigration enforcement. And I wish that the advocacy organizations that claim to speak for immigrants, who go around telling people that immigrants have to be afraid to report crimes because of cooperation with ICE, should be telling them that victims and witnesses are not subjects for immigration enforcement, and that that would be a much more constructed message that would help the immigrant community.
Thank you, Ms. Vaughn. Mr. Chairman, I simply do not understand how anyone could oppose enforcing current immigration laws. These unnecessary victims are not Republicans and not Democrats. They're innocent Americans, and immigration laws should be enforced by everyone in America. And yield back.
Chair, thanks to the former chairman of the committee and recognizes the gentlelady from Texas, Ms. Jackson Lee.
I thank the chairman and the ranking member, and Ms. Steinler. I add again, as I know all members have done, sympathy to you and your family. The sound of the violent act against your daughter simply penetrated around this nation and beyond. I would also indicate, Chief Jones, that any time we lose someone in the line of duty, we too feel that pain. And frankly, we should try to find the solutions that we need to find. So let me just offer a few thoughts in the instance of the facts in San Francisco, but I think it is important to join in my colleague from Texas and say that the laws that are on the books that are legal should be enforced as they relate to immigration issues in this country. Those of us who support comprehensive immigration reform in no way view that reform as coddling criminals. They stand aside from the population of families, of students, of workers who have come in this country to do good and not to do harm. And I think that when we get into a process of viewing one group of wanting not to abide by the immigration laws and another group as, then it is a misrepresentation of many of the American people who support our perspective. And I might just add one thought. When you have deferred adjudication, that is actually a legal use that can be utilized under the term prosecutorial discretion, which ICE has and a number of other agencies have. It's not in this instance that I think that prosecutorial discretion played out in any way. It did when we speak of these young dreamers that have been allowed to stay and go to school. But what I do want to make note of is that I wish the clock could have been turned back on this terrible tragedy. And just make mention that the individual in question in your daughter's tragic circumstances was in the Federal Bureau of Prisons. They did hold this individual in March 2015, transferred him to the custody of the San Francisco Sheriff's Office on a 20-year-old warrant for a marijuana charge, with the expectation that the district attorney would pursue. We wish this had not happened, but what did not happen, which was a simple act, is a phone call regarding Mr. Lopez Sanchez's statement or status. This bill dealing with the sanctuary cities and removing all opportunity for such cities, and frankly, why don't we all agree that that name connotes a problem for many? Because it suggests that you are giving sanctuary to everybody has a right to stay under that umbrella. Crooks and criminals and bad actors, and I want you to know that is absolutely not the case. It was utilized in a time when people came and did not speak English, and they were preyed upon. And the only way that the law enforcement officers could do their effective job was to be able to find out who did it. So I want to ask Chief, is that Chief? Yeah, I'm not seeing the name, and I'm looking for my list. I always like to call the name, but I will call it in a moment. But yes, did I characterize the way that the, if we use a different term other than sanctuary, we're not giving sanctuary to crooks and criminals, are we?
I'm sorry, Congresswoman, I can't quite hear your question.
Okay. With respect to sanctuary cities, we're not attempting to give, and I don't particularly hold to the name, it comes out of a religious basis of sanctuary, and I appreciate my faith community who started out trying to help people who were in need. Mm-hmm. My question to you is, in law enforcement, it is not a refuge for crooks and criminals. Is that correct? You don't. That's not the definition of sanctuary city.
I'm not aware, actually, what the exact definition is for sanctuary cities. I think the terminology is used as if it's understood what it actually means. Not being a sanctuary community, I can't really speak to the intent of those who have passed laws to and or other policies to, in fact, be a sanctuary city.
Well, let me just, without not being one, however, an overall position, you don't perceive that anyone is trying to protect anyone that is a criminal or established criminal record. You would not perceive that to be the case.
General Lady's out of time, but the chief may answer.
I'm sorry.
The general lady's out of time, but you may answer her question.
I can't think of anyone in professional law enforcement that would ever be their intent in adopting any policy that may be considered a sanctuary city.
I thank the chairman for allowing him to answer, and I have a number of statements from law enforcement that oppose H.R. 3009, Mr. Chairman, and the National League of Cities, the National Conference of Mayors, and the Major Sheriff's Association Fraternal Order of Police, and I ask that statement be put into the record.
Without objection, the chair will now recognize the gentleman from Iowa, Mr. King.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the witnesses for your testimony today, and I'm continually to be amazed at the composure that you're able to bring to this issue, Mr. Steinle. I wanted to inform you that some of us have been doing some things to try to move this Congress and this country in the right direction. I look back on testimony at this same table about the first year I came here in Congress, which would be around 2003 or 4. The witnesses were testifying then that of the number of people who died trying to get across the Arizona desert. I asked a witness who was seated in your seat, Chief Beal, I said, do you know, actually I asked each of the witnesses, he had an answer. I said, do you know how many Americans died at the hands of those who did make it into the United States? And his answer to me, and September 11th was fresher in our minds than it is today, he said, I don't know the number, but I can tell you it would be in multiples of the victims of September 11th. And at that point, I began the effort to get a GAO study, which Ms. Lofgren cooperated with me on. In 2005, April 2005, we got a study out. It wasn't quite apples to apples because we don't keep records well enough to have it exactly apples to apples. We refreshed that study again in March of 2011. I continued to bring amendments that cut off funding to sanctuary cities. I never believed that there should be a separation between the levels of law enforcement in this country. I grew up in a law enforcement family, and I understand the interrelationships that are part of the testimony we've heard here today. I wrote an op-ed last year, dated August 26th. It's in the National Review, the ACLU versus the rule of law. In it, I objected to the ICE detainer decision. What's been missing here is that then acting director of ICE, Dan Ragsdale, issued a statement, a letter to the political jurisdictions on February 25, 2014, that said that ICE detainers are not mandatory as a matter of law. And so this is initiated not by ICE, reacting to the ACLU's threat of lawsuits. That letter from ICE, I believe, contributed to this tragedy that we have here before us. And to change the word shall to now it's a suggestion. The last sentence in that op-ed says, as I wrote, if we bow to the outrageous demand of the ACLU and ignore detainer orders, the price will be paid by thousands of crime victims who would otherwise have been protected by law. I think we've clearly heard today the effect of that, and we've heard it from the expert testimony and very painful experiences. Mr. Steinle, on the day that I saw the news of your daughter's death, long before I knew it would be a national story, I sent out a tweet, and it's dated July 3rd, and it says this, 100% preventable crime, just enforce the law. This will make you cry too. And it happens every day. That was the Breitbart article from that day, and I sent out a subsequent tweet the following day, and it says this, this story happens every day in the U.S. And as of 2011, 25,064 criminal aliens were arrested for homicide in the United States. That says the end of 2010. How many since then? How big is that number? I look at the report and I do the math, that number comes to perhaps 48,000. I look at the crimes that have been committed by criminal aliens. This report, coupled with a subsequent report, brings us to a number in the area of 7,200,000 crimes, for perhaps less than around half of that many as crime victims. The devastation in this country because we refuse to enforce the law is breathtaking when you look at the statistics, and it is a tragedy that causes my hard heart to cry when I see what happened. And we knew it. This Congress knew it. I saw it 12 or 13 years ago. Many of us have seen it, but because of political desires, people that gain a political advantage from having the political support, they're pandering to and catering to people that they know are lawbreakers. And this tragedy was 100% preventable. I feel like I ought to ask a question. So I want to say, Sheriff Jones, I think your testimony has been very specific and very well informed. And I'd ask if you could comment on what I said about ICE detainer orders.
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, it's important to note that even under the Priority Enforcement Program, prior removal, multiple felonies, any felony conviction as long as it's not aggravated, extensive gang activity, and any misdemeanor convictions won't get you in the first priority. But even if you were in the first priority, ICE detainers are not working. It's naive to believe, to assert that for the most offensive crimes that we're able to hold the person until ICE can get down, even if we notify them. If Ms. Steinle's murderer were somehow released from court today, they would not hold them 1 minute for them to get out of custody. There is no, I can't even honor an ICE detainer for the person that killed my officer that's currently in custody. If he were to somehow get released or charges dismissed, he would get out before ICE would ever come down to the jail. By ICE's own numbers, their in-custody arrests are down 95% over a year ago. That's 95%. That's more than just folks that are falling in the first priority. That is almost every single person escaping consequence for being in this country illegally or whatever crimes they may have committed.
Thank you, Sheriff. And I just say to the Chairman all that the families that have suffered this kind of tragedy that was 100% preventable are becoming the equivalent of Gold Star families here in this country. And I want to honor you and thank you. And I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. The Chair will now recognize the gentleman from Colorado, the former District Attorney, Mr. Buck.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Sheriff Jones, how long have you been with the Sheriff's Office? I heard earlier, but I forgot.
Since 1989.
Okay. And in your office or in your jail, I take it that you implement a program with ICE.
We do. We cooperate with ICE to the extent we're able to.
And that program, at least when I was in local law enforcement, used to be known as the 287 program or 287G program.
That's correct.
And it requires you to send some of your deputies to be trained with ICE. Is that my understanding?
There is a training component. I'm not certain as I sit here what it is. We have a large jail. We're right next to a federal courthouse. And so we have a pretty handy ICE presence in our jail. They're able to be in our jail, unlike many jails.
And when I was district attorney, I inquired of ICE how they found out about individuals' nationality and made their determination. And I was concerned with profiling issues because they were raised to me. My understanding is that ICE asks neutral questions to begin their questioning. They'll ask something like, where were you born? And they will ask that of everyone that they take, everyone that they interview in custody. Is that your understanding?
That's correct. But because of Secure Communities and its progeny, they will already have an indication many times if there's a fingerprint match if someone's in the country illegally.
If they don't have that indication, they will still ask the neutral question of everyone. They won't just ask people who speak Spanish or people who speak a foreign language. They will ask that question of everyone that's in custody, taken in that day, for example.
That's correct, or folks that have self-indicated that they were born outside of the United States or are here illegally.
Okay. And I have seen, in my experience, changes in the morale of the ICE agents that are working there. Many of the ICE agents that I deal with feel like they have they have been handcuffed by this administration recently. Do you have that feeling also in the ICE agents that you work with?
Absolutely, I do. The line level officers in both ICE and us have the same desire, and that's to keep the community safe. So they took an oath. They have a mission. They're not being allowed to carry out that mission. That morale issue was discussed and addressed by the administration with a raise, but that is not what's giving the ICE officers at the line level poor morale.
Can you pay a law enforcement officer enough to ignore crime?
No.
We do it. We did it. I did it, or we do it for other reasons. We do it because we feel like we make our communities safer. We do it because we want to help people around us. We don't do it for another $1,000 a year in pay. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, it's, as I said earlier, it's a calling. We don't choose law enforcement, it chooses us.
And you've mentioned a statistic that shows decreased crime, but it's also your sense that there is decreased enforcement as a result of changes in administration policy.
There is undoubtedly less enforcement on immigration issues and certainly detainers as a result of policy.
And that's what you hear anecdotally from the people that you deal with in ICE.
Oh, absolutely.
Chief Beal, as part of your job as I wanted to mention something also, Sheriff Jones. I really appreciate you drawing the distinction between sheriffs and chiefs, and it is something that I've noticed. Chiefs are appointed by mayors typically, or city councils, or administrators who work for mayors and city councils in areas that tend, in urban areas, and they tend to be more liberal and they tend to have more liberal policies. Sheriffs run for election, they deal with individuals, they have a sense of the community that far exceeds, at least in my experience, that of a police chief. We have had so many times in the Colorado legislature bills that have been supported by sheriffs and opposed by chiefs, bills that have been supported by chiefs and opposed by sheriffs. Two very different spokesmen or women for law enforcement. I appreciate you drawing that distinction. Chief Beal, I want to ask you really quickly, do you have a task force, for example, with DEA when you deal with drug cases?
Absolutely.
And in those task forces, you gather intelligence and share that intelligence with DEA.
That is correct. We actually are on the DEA task force.
Okay. And the same is true if you know of a large gun running organization, a national gun running, you would share information with ATF.
That is correct.
And I take it if you heard of some international terrorist organization, you would share information with the FBI.
We are a member of the FBI, JTTF, Joint Terrorism Task Force.
And but when you go, when your officer shows up at a domestic violence situation, what you're telling me is they do not make inquiries about nationality, and they would not share information if they had a suspicion about someone being in this country illegally.
It would for the victim, absolutely not. In fact, what we do is try to work with victims to have an advocate work with them and see if they're eligible for a U visa application. So that's one of the community partnerships we have. If the person is a suspect, it would really depend on the circumstances. If the assistance of the immigration would be helpful in our investigation, do they bring something additional to the table that will help us in this case or not? We have the authority to act on that case and take that person into custody. When they get to jail, they will be screened through ICE.
And I'm out of time, but you distinguish between the various types of crime and how you you interact with
Correct.
The federal government.
Correct.
Thank you.
Chairman, Colorado yields back. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Texas, the former U.S. Attorney, Mr. Radcliffe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Steinley, as the father of two daughters, I can't begin to comprehend the grief that you've endured over the last 3 weeks, and I'd like to join all of my colleagues, or many of them, in expressing my deepest condolences to you and to your entire family. Can I ask you whether in the last 3 weeks President Obama has expressed his condolences to you?
I didn't hear the question.
Yeah, can I ask you if in the last 3 weeks President Obama has expressed his condolences to you or your family? Well, I'm very sorry to hear that. When there have been other very public deaths in this country, like Michael Brown and Trayvon Martin and Freddie Gray, the president has expressed his condolences to the family. I would have expected him to do that here. he did more than express his condolences in those cases. He had a lot to say about those circumstances, I think, because they tied into policies that he cared about, like gun control and alleged police profiling. And yet, when one of his policies with respect to immigration enforcement is at the root of a problem here that we're all discussing today, we don't hear anything from him, and you didn't hear anything from him. About the kindest thing I can say about that is that's incredibly disheartening and troubling to me. Because I very much believe that that the loss that you have experienced is unacceptable, if for no other reason that it was entirely preventable had the immigration laws in our country been enforced. And this administration has frankly refused to uphold the law. And its inaction has emboldened cities across the country, like San Francisco, to ignore and in some cases actually obstruct enforcement of our immigration laws. And we all know that the status quo isn't working. And since the administration isn't going to apparently do anything about that, Congress has to step in and act. And today the House is expected to vote on a bill that would deny certain federal funds to sanctuary cities. And I do think that's a good first step. I agree with Ms. Vaughn that's all it is, that it's just a good first step, and that we certainly have to do more, and that we have to have the courage and conviction not to do just to do more, but to do what's right. So, Ms. Vaughn, let me ask you a question. In your testimony, you noted that detainers have been used for decades and have been viewed by law enforcement as mandatory rather than just optional. In your opinion, what do you think is at the root of this dramatic departure from prior interpretations?
I believe that this whole series of events of more and more jurisdictions becoming sanctuaries was set off by the policy change at ICE to suddenly declare that detainers were optional. In this letter that Mr. King referred to from Dan Ragsdale, to just suddenly declare that they were optional, not mandatory, with no legal foundation whatsoever that, to my knowledge, has ever been made public as to what, legal reasoning they had for changing that policy. But once that was done, that then provided legal cover for all of these other jurisdictions around the country to change their policies to stop complying with the detainers. And it also provided an opening for groups like the ACLU to threaten litigation against those sheriffs who are complying with detainers. And I think that's why it's very important that that language such as that in the Davis-Oliver Act be included in any effort to address the sanctuaries to protect those law enforcement agencies that are doing the right thing and complying with all detainers all the time, so that they aren't going to be held responsible, knowing that ICE's policy nowadays is not to assist them in litigation, even if it's ICE's mistake. We have to give them cover and protection and qualified immunity to do the right thing in these cases in complying with detainers.
Thank you, Ms. Vaughn. I appreciate you being here. I found your testimony earlier compelling. Sheriff Jones, I found yours compelling as well, and I'd like to give you an opportunity because you talked about this same issue about detainers being interpreted as mandatory previously rather than just requests. And I'd like to ask you the same question about whether you have an opinion about what's caused this dramatic shift.
The gentleman's out of time, Sheriff, but you may answer the gentleman's question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The clearly it's policy differences, and obviously as the member pointed out, these policy and the preferences came about long before the decision in Clackamas County, Oregon. That was just a catalyst and a vehicle for them to make that a nationwide policy shift. You have to understand that the DHS Assistant Secretary over State and Local Law Enforcement is Heather Fong. She's the former police chief of San Francisco. So not saying anything about her competence as police chief or in the position she currently holds, but that does give you some insight into the political will and mindset of this administration.
Thank you. I appreciate y'all being here, and I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Chair, thanks. The former U.S. Attorney, and recognize the gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Trott.
I want to thank the chair for organizing this hearing today and all the witnesses for sharing their insight. I also want to thank my good friend from Texas for his question. Mr. Steinle, I was going to ask you if the president had reached out to you, but I decided not to do that because I assumed that, of course, he had done that, so I'm sorry that hasn't happened. I thank you for your courage in being here today, and I, too, hope this is just a beginning. And my question is to Ms. Vaughn. One of my concerns is I'm going to support H.R. 3009. I'm going to vote for it this afternoon. But it really has to be just a beginning because it targets about $800 million of money for law enforcement. And my concern, and I'd like you to is it has to be just a first step because many times law enforcement, sheriffs and police chiefs are following the directive of a city council or a mayor or a county commission. And I think we have to go further upstream and withhold Tiger Grant money for road funding for sanctuary cities that decide to ignore federal law. I think we have to make the repercussions of a sanctuary city deciding to ignore federal law much more severe than H.R. 3009. Can you give any suggestions or thoughts in that regard?
Well, again, I think a lot of the language that's in the Davis-Oliver Act is very comprehensive in addressing this problem. I do agree with you that, you know, money talks. In many cases, these are not, in most cases, sanctuary policies are not something that law enforcement agencies ask for. They're imposed on them usually by political elected officials. And so, but money is a way to target them. We can come up with objective ways to define what a sanctuary is, and I think it should be a jurisdiction that does not comply with all detainers all the time for all types of people who are removable, whether they've committed serious crimes or not. And I do think that the policies of the Obama administration in enabling sanctuary jurisdictions and greatly restricting what ICE agents can do, despite the plain language of the law, also ought to be given attention through legislation from Congress, because we know that the administration is not going to make an effort. They've said as much. They're not going to address this on their own, and so Congress needs to reassert its constitutional authority over these matters.
Thank you. Chief Beal, during your testimony, you commented that resources are finite. It's difficult for police departments to balance the different needs, and the federal immigration laws on some level are a distraction, perhaps, in balancing all the different demands on your police officers. That's true of so many things today in state and federal government, so it's not unique to whether we should enforce our immigration laws. You agree with that?
I think it raises the issue of where we spend our enforcement resources always. How do we prioritize what we do? Right. In fact, that's what every police chief and every sheriff across this country does. That is what the federal administration is attempting to do, I would believe, as it relates to immigration enforcement policy, to try to do everything. Right. We do nothing well. So we focus, we're very strategic in how we deploy resources. That's how we are effective. Right.
But if we boil it down, what we're talking about with respect to today's tragedy that led to this hearing is a phone call, right?
I think I've already testified in effect that the notification should have been made. In fact, I think we need to move just a little bit back upstream, that the federal government had the capability to act on that deportation without ever involving San Francisco authorities.
Right.
And I haven't heard that comment on much today.
Right.
The authority existed, the capability, ability to take action existed, and somehow that is not being recognized, I think.
In your testimony, you kind of suggested that sanctuary cities maybe are helpful insofar as unlawful immigrants are not afraid to report crimes. Ms. Vaughn disagrees with that, suggests it's a myth. You want to comment on that?
I think we just see this differently. Mine is based on my actual experience within my city, so I yield to my experience.
Okay. Mr. Sheriff Jones, the president's policy is just to seek custody of folks that have been convicted of crimes, not charged. You want to comment on that?
Well, I can say that the only vehicle for that to happen, the only vehicle for the federal government or ICE to be notified of that is the detainer process. And as I've tried to illustrate, the detainer process is not working. We are not able to honor ICE detainers for 1 second after their local charges are cleared. Now, if someone's sentenced to local time doing time in jail, then ICE can have a pretty decent idea, relatively accurate idea of when they're getting out. And for those folks, it might still be effective. But for the 58,000 people that I book in my jail every year that overwhelmingly mostly get out on their own recognizance, bail perhaps, they're able to bail, they get released from court. That happens with no notice or warning to ICE, and they do not have the ability to run down to the jail before I have to release them.
Thank you, Sheriff. And Mr. Steinle, I'll close with this. I'm out of time, but the head of Amtrak apparently couldn't find time a few months back after the tragedy in Philadelphia to call the 8 families that were affected by that. So apparently there's a pattern in practice here in Washington of people not being considerate of the tragedies that affect our citizens. Thank you. I yield back.
General from Michigan yields back. Chair recognizes himself for 5 minutes. Mr. Steinle, I want to thank you for beautifully capturing the essence of who your daughter was. And I have read everything that I can get my hands on, and I last night watched the clips of various family members describing your daughter, and she is precisely the kind of person that our country desperately needs. So I want to thank you for sharing her with us today.
If I may, I'd like to recognize my sisters here in grief that's supported us during this. They've been there, done that, and we're going to carry this forward, and hopefully some good will come from Kate's death. Thank you.
Yes, sir, which is a perfect segue. I was going to thank Chief Beal and Sheriff Jones and ask that they specifically tell the women and men that work with them how grateful all of us are for folks who go into that profession and that calling. And I suspect that both the chief and the sheriff and the women and men that work with them would tell you that there are lots of really hard parts of being in law enforcement. The crime scene photos never leave your head. You never get them out. The crime scenes themselves, you never get out. But the hardest part for most law enforcement officers that I talk to is having to talk to the families, like the 4 ladies sitting right behind you, because they got really good questions. Why? Why did this happen? How did this happen? And those questions go all the way up to the theological. Those aren't just law enforcement questions. They are life-altering, lifelong questions. So tell the folks that you work with how grateful we are. Sheriff, this is something that I am struggling to understand. ICE had probable cause for Mr. Francisco Lopez Sanchez, correct? I mean, he's a 5-time convicted illegal entrant. I think even some of the members of this panel could have won that case in court. So he had probable cause.
That is my understanding.
Why not a warrant? Why a detainer?
You know, I wouldn't claim to be an insider into the dynamics. I've talked to some of my friends in ICE about that particular case. There were certainly failures, but it is an overarching policy-level decision to not challenge or enforce the existing immigration laws or challenge contrary laws that led, at least in part, to the release of this suspect.
But surely even sanctuary cities like San Francisco would have to honor a federal warrant.
Clearly.
Because the Bureau of Prisons honored a local warrant.
Yes, and we've had this discussion about why don't you just create the detainer process into somewhat of a probable cause declaration and have them reviewed by a magistrate. And they say, well, it's caseload prohibitive, but there are 93 federal districts in this country, including 3 territorial district courts. And if we were to supply 1 additional magistrate to each of those districts, I'm sure they could handle the workload of reviewing the probable cause detainer declarations. These things are easily fixable. There just has to be a desire and the political will to be able to do that.
Well, I want to give you one other way to fix it, Chief, and I'll go to you for this one. San Francisco wound up dismissing that warrant, correct?
And I would have expected that, quite honestly, in my experience. I'd be shocked if that case would have gone forward.
But they could have dismissed it while he was halfway through his federal prison sentence.
Absolutely.
They could have dismissed it when he had a month to go in his federal prison sentence.
That is correct.
They could have dismissed it at any point in his federal prison sentence. Therefore, he never would have been returned to the city of San Francisco.
That is a fact.
And if I were Mr. Steinle, those are some of the questions that I probably would be asking. Is you knew you were going to dismiss this warrant. You knew that. Mm-hmm. Hell, I'm not even sure drugs are still illegal in San Francisco. So you knew that case was not going to be prosecuted. Why did you wait until he was in your custody to dismiss it, leading to this result? All right, I want to move to one other thing, to both my law enforcement officers. Have you ever noticed throughout the pendency of your careers that folks start with misdemeanors and then they kind of work their way up to aggravated misdemeanors and then they get into to felonies? Rarely do you go from 0 to 100 miles an hour. Rarely. And when you do go from 0 to 100 miles an hour and commit a murder or a sexual assault or a kidnapping, you're in jail. If you've got a decent prosecutor and a halfway decent case, those folks are already locked up. So since we accept the fact that you don't go from 0 to 100, I think we're missing the boat if we focus solely on felonies when it comes to background checks for folks who want to be in this country. I think you ought to look, all misdemeanors aren't the same. Mm-hmm. You know, speeding is a violation. DUI is worse. Recidivist DUI are worse. Property damage DUI is even worse. Personal injury DUI is even worse. I get all that. But this obsession that we have with only felons, we can only deport felons. Sheriff, has that been your experience, that people who commit misdemeanors always learn their lessons and never graduate?
Clearly some do, but the best predictor of future behavior is past behavior. And I think there are studies that will demonstrate that there generally is an escalation of criminality, especially when you don't have the consequences to try and deter the behavior. And it's not just felonies that are getting deported, it's only aggravated felonies. So there are many felony convictions that escape scrutiny whatsoever, even under the highest priority of the priority enforcement program.
All right, I'm out of time, but I want to ask one final question because this deals with broader issues of immigration. I want to assume for the sake of argument that there are 11 million undocumented folks in the country. Let's assume that. And I don't know what the percentages is. Ms. Vaughn, maybe you do. Of that 11 million, what percentage have either felony or serious, what we would consider to be serious misdemeanor criminal histories?
I don't know the exact answer to that. ICE estimates that there are more than 2 million criminal aliens in the United States.
All right, let's do this.
1.9 million are removable because some of them have green cards.
Well, let's do this. Just for the sake of conservatism, let's cut that in half. Let's say it's 1 million. Let's err on the side of being conservative. What is the administration's plan for removing those 1 million? To wait until they reoffend? Does anyone know the plan? This is not a rhetorical question. I'm honestly asking, if the strategy is to wait until those 1 million reoffend, somebody's going to be apologizing to a whole lot of moms and dads. Is there another strategy that either of the law enforcement professionals or Ms. Vaughn, is there a strategy other than simply waiting for that 1 million to reoffend? If you can't ask about status, if you can't place a detainer, how are we going to identify that universe, however small it may be? If you're Mr. Steinle, it doesn't matter if it's one. What is our plan to identify that universe before they reoffend? Not all at once.
Mr. Chairman, I just would suggest that the federal government, ICE, certainly should have an idea based on their database, which isn't shared with local law enforcement, of who those individuals are and who poses significant risk, and they have the ability to take action And if they need the assistance of local law enforcement, they certainly can request that.
When you say take action, you mean wait for them to do something else wrong where they interact with law enforcement?
They have the ability to take proactive action, just like any police officer does.
But there are less ICE agents than there are officers from certain big cities in the United States. There are 5,000. All right, I'm out of time. I can't ask about U visas. I'll close in just a second. I want to recognize my colleague from California for any closing remarks you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I first would like to ask unanimous consent to put in the record the priorities for removal. There have been several comments made here that are just not correct. The priorities for removal are priority 1, A, B, C, D, and E, and priority 2, A, and B. And what that is, terrorism, gang, any felony, as well as any aggravated felony under priority 2, and this is equal with 1, 3 or more misdemeanors other than traffic, and significant misdemeanors, which includes a single DUI, no matter when that offense was included. Those are all priorities for removal. I would just note that no system is perfect, and clearly there was a failure here in San Francisco. I mean, there is no question about that. I think your question about the warrant is a good one, and one we ought to explain. One of the reasons I think every jurisdiction has a multiplicity of bench warrants that have been issued, and there generally is no process for going back and taking a look at old bench warrants to see whether they ought to be dismissed. Maybe that is part of the answer. On the other hand, if the bench warrant was not for a drug offense but for a rape, you wouldn't want that dismissed. So, you know, we need to sort through with some granularity to make sure that we're actually solving a problem and not creating new ones. And I would just close with saying that although the system is far from perfect, it is often the case that individuals who have either no status or they've gained status, who commit an offense, are the subject of enforcement actions. In fact, I've met a number of people who are legal permanent residents of the United States who've lost their legal permanent residence because they've been convicted of a crime that allows them to be removed. So I'm not saying it's perfect, but it is far from rare. I think that as we move forward in this, we have plenty of questions and an opportunity to work together to make sure that this whole system works better for the safety of our community. And I thank you, Mr. Chairman, for recognizing me, and I yield back.
The gentlelady yields back. And with respect to the warrants, the gentlelady is exactly right. I do want them enforced, particularly if there's a victim involved. But it's really easy. You just tell the prosecutor and the local law enforcement agency, you have X amount of time with which to resolve this warrant. You can try it, you can plead it, you can dismiss it. That's up to you. But you're going to return this person back to the agency or entity from which they came. You are not going to release them. That's an easy fix. Give California, give San Francisco 30 days. It's 20 years old. Good luck finding the witnesses. My concern more is that all of that could have been done while that person was serving a prison sentence. All of it could have been done. So, let me just, in closing, Chief Beal, Sheriff Jones, I wanted to tell you, I think you've got folks on task forces. I don't know if you have folks on task forces or not. They're probably federal task forces. They may be RICO. They may be OSADF. Those are pretty complex matters, too. If you've ever tried to unlock a federal RICO case, hell, for that matter, state DUI laws are 16 pages long. And your guys are smart enough to do DUI law, so I reject the notion that somehow immigration law is too complex for state and local law enforcement. But I want to end the same way I started, Mr. Steinle, by thanking you for your courage. For those of us that are parents, or frankly, even if you're not a parent, I could not do what you have done. I could not have the grace. I couldn't do it. So thank you. Ms. Vaughn, thank you, and Sheriff Jones and Chief Beal, if you would be kind enough to let the women and men that work with you know how grateful we are for their service. With that, members have 5 legislative days to put whatever they want in the record, and with that, we are adjourned.